Hello and welcome everybody to lecture 5.1. This week we will look at the problem of state estimation, and this will actually keep us busy for the next 2 weeks, because then next week we will use the basics that we introduced this week to introduce the Kalman filter and then show how we can use that to estimate the pose of a quadrotor even from noisy measurements such as visual odometry or GPS. So before we dive more into the technical problems, I first want to clarify a few terms. As you know from last week, we can describe the state of our system with a variable, which is then typically referred to as the system state or the world state. This world state represents then the current state of the system. So for example, if we have a quadrotor flying in the 3D world, we could describe its state using a three-dimensional vector describing its position. If it's hovering above a landing site at the same time, we could also, depending on the task that we're looking at, we could also model its relative position to this landing site, or the position of the landing site in the world and the quadrotor in the world. So when we talk about the world state, then we mean it's the actual state of the world, the actual position of the quadrotor in the world. Of course, we need an internal representation then of this world state, because we need this world state for applying our PID controller, for example. And this is then called the belief state, which is the internal representation of this world state. And it's important to note here that this belief state does not necessarily have to match the real world state, because as you know, all sensors or all observations that we can make are noisy. So it's not guaranteed that what the robot actually thinks where it is actually where it really is. Good. So we've already discussed this a little bit. The question then, of course, is what are the relevant parts of the world state that we really need to model? And that depends to a great deal, of course, on the task at hand that we try to solve. So for a quadrotor in general, it's of course very important that we know its position in the world. And then typically this is somewhere between a two-dimensional position or a three-dimensional position, or maybe even a 6-degree-of-freedom pose in 3D space. We're generally also interested in the velocity. We need that, remember, for the derivative part in the PID controller. We might also be interested, if we're flying through the world, of course, we want to know where the obstacles are. Maybe if we need to do path planning, we also need the map. And then all of these components actually are part of the world state and need to be represented somehow, both by the world state, but also in our belief state of the world state. There might be other things like other objects in the world that we might be interested in, humans, for example, or other robots if the quadrotor is exploring an environment in a swarm. And yeah, as I said, depending on the application that you're looking at, there might be much more things that you might have to represent in your world state. The problem with that in general is that without sensors, we cannot directly observe the world state. Also, we need it, so we need to estimate it somehow. And there are two sources of information generally on a robot. The first one is that we carry along a large number of sensors, of course, so we can try to infer the world state from the sensor readings. Second option is that we know which actions that we send to our motors, so we can use that to compute an odometry, for example, as you've already done. So from the actions that we've given to the robot, we can then again infer the world state. And ideally, of course, you would like to use both the sensor observations and the issued motion commands that you've sent to the motors. Good. So let's first start now with the sensor model. As we said, the robot perceives its environment and its the world state through its sensors. And this is typically then modeled using a so-called sensor function. A sensor function takes the world state as input and then generates a sensor reading. In practice, of course, this is then implemented in hardware because you have a real sensor that you apply to the real world, and then it spits out a sensor reading. And then our goal is to invert this process and to infer the state of the world from the sensor readings that we made using the sensor. Similarly, we can define something similar to for the motion model. So imagine that we have executed a certain action or given a certain control command U to our robot, for example, that we wanted to move forward at a certain speed. Then we can update our belief state about the world state according to a particular sensor, a particular motion model. For example, given the previous state and the executed action, we can then compute what the most likely state will be where we are in. Good. And the problem here in general is that all sensor observations that we are getting are noisy, are potentially missing, are only partially observe the world state. And so it's not easy to infer from the sensor observations directly the world state. The second problem is that all models that we can think of and that we can specify are actually partially wrong by definition, because a model can only be specific up to a certain degree, and they will also be incomplete because there are some effects that you cannot model or that you don't want to model because it would make your model too complicated. As a last point, we have typically some prior knowledge about the application in general, or how the environment looks like, or how the robot behaves. And this is something that we want to include, of course, in our inference process. Good. And this in altogether then now leads to the so-called probabilistic robotics paradigm, where we say that we cannot be sure, absolutely sure, of any of these variables, but what we can do is to specify probabilistic models to describe it. So for example, instead of having this deterministic sensor function that maps the world to one sensor reading, we introduce a probabilistic sensor model that defines a probability distribution over possible sensor readings given a particular world state. Similarly, we can define a probabilistic motion model then that says that when we are in a certain state and we give a certain motion command, that there is a certain probability of possible outcomes, or the probability distribution over the possible outcomes then of this action. And then we have to look at two inference problems. Namely, first of all, we want to fuse data between multiple sensor sources. So, for example, if we have a camera that provides us some readings, an ultrasound sensor and an IMU sensor, we want to combine all of these sensor observations into a single estimate of the world state. And then we're not only making a single observation of a sensor, but of course we get continuously sensor readings from these sensors, so we want to fuse it also over time. This is then called filtering. And then the Kalman filter that we will look at next week is a very efficient variant of a filter to do that. This could, for example, just be based on the sensor readings that we're getting. But as we said before, ideally, we want to fuse the data both from our sensors, the encoded by set 1 to set t, and our motion commands that we gave in between, here denoted by u1 to ut. So to summarize this, we've introduced the concept of the world state in the real world and then the internal belief state of the robot. We've looked at sensor models and motion models, we motivated why we need probability theory then to model the uncertainty that arises from different sources. And then in the next video, we will give a brief recap on probability theory, just as a refresher that all of us are on the same page.